School and Higher School of Economics here in St. Petersburg branch. And now she's leading one of the best internet labs, I think, in the world, honestly. She's leading, and she has created the internet, the Lab for Internet Studies, the Laboratory of Internet Studies at National Research University, Higher School of Economics. She's also a founding member of Computational Methods Division Computational Methods and Communication Division for International Communication Association. So she is a person who can give us some hints on how today to deal with this era of closing data. I like very much this wording, and I want Vanessa to sort of to expand this and to explain what she means by this. So floor is yours, Vanessa. Thanks for coming.
That your microphone doesn't function.
Hello.
Yeah,
that's good.
Thank you.
Okay. So we'll be talking not only about the research results, but also the events that now are surrounding the sphere of internet science and influencing it. And my talk will be provocative, and I will be talking about how data sets are closing and what consequences it has on the internet research, what we are losing, what we could have done if we had more data, what can be done about it. So there can be a lot of arguments against this position, but this talk is aimed specifically at promoting discussion in this field. So let's start with the tweets. Suppose you come online and you see a picture like this. So what does it tell us? It tells you actually that you could submit 300 words for a social networking site. This social networking site will net about you more than 1,000 words. And if you submit just 70 words, it will know you as well as your close friends. So what is a natural reaction to this such picture? Of course, it attracts attention, and it is meant to attract attention, and it can soothe anxiety into the body. But let's look at the source of this picture. Where does it come from? Do some critical reading about it. This is a famous study by Mikhail Kosinski and colleagues. Mikhail Kosinski worked at that time at Cambridge University. So it's a classical psychological study where he and his colleagues try to predict psychological personality traits known in psychology as Big Five, you can see on the left. But they use an innovative design, and innovative at that time, in 2014 or 13 when they collected the data. So they developed an app for Facebook, and 70,000 people filled a psychological questionnaire, and then additional 17,000 friends and relatives also tried to guess personality traits of their loved ones, and then they trained a machine learning algorithm who tried to act as a human and also tried to guess personality traits of those who filled the questionnaire. And so if you look at the results, what can you see? You can see the x-axis. Here you can see problem. You can see the number of likes submitted to the system. And here you can see the accuracy from like 0% to 100%. And if you look here, yes, of course, you can see that if you submit 300 likes, the accuracy of the system will be higher than that of our spouse. So here. But actually, well, this red or brown, it's brown line, is averaged across all five grades. 5% of the threads. So it looks like at the first glance that computer beats the humans, and soon the robots will be ruling the world. But if you look at the absolute numbers of accuracy, you just see that both humans and the machine are a little bit better than coin tossing. So they are like, it's a little bit better than random guessing. And if you ask for my opinion, what is the chance of this algorithm getting better in the near future? I will say that the way it's done now, it's a very long way still to go. First of all, because personality traits that are being predicted is a vague concept, and this is a latent variable that nobody has ever seen, and there is a big question of ground truth there behind it. What is the ground truth? What is the right way to measure this big problem? And the second and the most important is that the way machine learning is working now is nothing close to human thinking. It doesn't incorporate human experience in the way human brain incorporates it. And before a machine learns to think as smart as humans, it will not exceed humans in anything. But let's go further. What happened next after this research that produced really very modest results? What was the continuation of the story? And this continuation is known as Cambridge Analytica scandal. And I always ask people two questions concerning this. Who of you have heard about Cambridge Analytica scandal? Just heard. Nearly everybody has heard. Who, next question, who of you can trace the major sequence of events in this scandal? That's a huge difference. Everybody has heard, but very few can trace. This is not an accusation. This is an illustration of how media work. So everybody is, in a way, anxiety about this. But what's the story is about? Even an interested audience, an audience that is interested in internet research, an audience that has come to a conference on internet research, is not sure about what really happened there, and what the buzzer is about. So, okay, there is a guy named Cogan, and he was at Cambridge University. He is an associate professor there. And he approached Kaczynski to produce and ask him to produce another data set. Kaczynski declined this collaboration, and so Cogan collected the data himself. Very similar to what Kaczynski did. It was absolutely legal at that time, and in compliance with all Facebook terms of use. But then, what Kaczynski did, he allegedly transferred, okay, he said, he actually admits that he transferred his data, actually sold it to Cambridge Analytica company. Cambridge Analytica company is a company, that a marketing firm, that helps win elections for, all over the world, including some countries and candidates with dubious reputation. And allegedly, according to the Guardian, I don't know if you can see, but this is the vision. This entire picture is the vision of the Guardian, the newspaper. So according to the Guardian, this data was used in an electoral campaign in the last presidential elections in the United States. Cambridge Analytica denies even the fact of using this data in this campaign, to say nothing of them having influence on the outcome of this election. But the version of the Guardian is that it did contribute to Trump's victory. Okay, what happened next after that? Okay, Trump won. What was the reaction of Facebook? And here, some of you may have heard that Mark Zuckerberg was summoned to, to Congress and to the Senate, and he was interrogated there, and there is a huge buzz in the United States that Facebook has been contributing to to shady technologies of electoral campaigning. It is not secure against breaches, and it also allows commercial state political propaganda. And Facebook's reaction was to restrict data access. So what you could do back in 2015 in terms of developing research applications and registering them with Facebook is no longer possible. It has become virtually impossible. But Mark Zuckerberg wants his image to be good, so he has collaborated with a number of prominent American scholars, including famous Professor Garrett King from Harvard, to establish an independent research committee that would be assessing applications from different scholars to Facebook data, and that will be approving or disapproving these applications, and those applications that are approved will get the data sets from Facebook. This sounds as a very good and democratic and balanced approach. However, why then this initiative was on elections? As Eric King told me, they hope to have a whole series of research topics in the future. And he has even told me that Russians are also eligible for applying. So if there are any Russians who want to apply, please try. And we will see what comes out of it. But so far, it's only one topic. As we know from other campaign or other research programs of other networks and other data holders, commercial data holders, usually these grants are very few, like ridiculously few, like 5 grants or five applications, 3 applications, and so on. So this is the largest social networking site in the world, actually. Near monopolist of social networking in the world is closing from data access. There were some proponents here of a position that actually maybe you don't really need those data, so let's do the research that we can do ourselves, forget about Facebook. I would argue with this position because there is a number of problems. I was going also to tell you about Russian connection, but let's keep this. Okay. So there is a number of research questions that for which you really need large connected data. Actually, the virtue of digital traces is that they are collected. This is why they are especially valuable. When you have the data about a large number of persons or a large number of entities and connections between this. This allows you to get different valuable information, like obtaining group demographics and clustering entities into groups, like obtaining collective opinion. Because online opinion is not an opinion obtained through polls where you have isolated opinion items. The virtue of studying online opinion with the user-generated text, with natural text, is that you can see the dynamics of opinion formation and you can see it as a process and a collective action in a way. Not a political collective action, but a collective creation of senses, meanings, and opinions. And most of all, of course, there is an enormous number of questions you can't answer when you don't have network data and the data about the ties. And this last type of data and last type of research questions are the ones I will be concentrating on further in this talk. Because they are the most indicative of the situation, and second, because we will be talking about textual analysis further on the workshop in this conference. So ironically, how many Russians are here? Russians raising their hands. Is it the Russian dominated audience? Not so much. So for those who are from outside Russia, it might be a sort of contradiction of terms. How can it be that in Russia So how can it be that in Russia researchers could have more research opportunities in terms of internet research than in other countries? And Russia seems to be a very restricted and very closed country from the outside. But there are some, like, it's not that easy. Processes are never so unidirectional in any society. For some reason, Antarctica has been always more open in terms of data access than Facebook, and is still more open, although it's gradually moving towards greater closure. I want to just to entertain you a little bit. Are there any versions, opinions? Why is that set? There is a closed democratic government in Russia that wants to restrict everything, or at least is perceived to be restricted. I regret that all of Kentucky experts are not.
Why are some places more open than Facebook?
In terms of data access.
There is no stakeholder who might be interested in closing citizen data in Russia. There is no society which says, we want our privacy.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So people are less aware about their rights and less conscious. There is less civil society or whatever.
Probably it's not about public opinion, but about what the market needs and companies. So it's private data is not as a luxury product in Russia in comparison to US, for example.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. I don't want to give any final answer because I'm not the god to give final answers. And this is, yes, this is an open question, in fact. Well, from my observations, I can see that, of course, both Kentucky and Facebook have similar commercial incentives, but they are really experiencing different external pressures, as Polina has said, and therefore they adapt their commercial strategies to those pressures. There is no pressure on Kentucky to close the data from a political or civil point of view. However, Kentucky is increasingly experiencing commercial pressures. Like, there is a whole series of court disputes about using the data for creating a banking scoring system. There was an independent commercial company that downloaded all Kentucky data, built its own banking scoring system, and started selling it. And from then on, Kentucky has been in court with it in the disputes, and the legislation, thanks to this dispute, has started moving towards more closer, or more data protection, as you wish to interpret it. So my vision is that we will still be moving towards more closed data in Kentucky, but probably not as fast as Facebook is doing now.
So I want to touch
four questions here, for which you need connected data. First, if you have pro-social groups in Kentucky, it is really important for, in terms of normative theory of democracy, to understand whether they are effective, why they are effective or ineffective, and what can be done to help them to become more effective. This is one side of the coin. The other side of So the other side is, okay, we all want to live in a good society with a lot of pro-social groups whose data are protected, nobody wants to live like in Chicago of the 1930s with a lot of corruption, crime, poverty, unemployment, and whatever. So imagine there is an antisocial movement in Turkey or another social movement. So can you imagine that a drug dealer who uses a social networking site for the drug distribution would give you an informed consent to study his networks in order to understand how networks are being used for this kind of activity? Can you imagine a radical Ku Klux Klan or any nationalistic political activist to give you informed consent on that? And are we really sure that we should solicit consent in this type of research? This is a question. Next question is the most simple. Even you, if you just study a group of whales, I don't know, anything, like car consumers or, I don't know, bike activists or healthy lifestyle activists, if you want to understand how different they are from the general population, you need to know something about general population. In classical sociology, I mean, we use census data as a benchmark, as a background, to understand how different it is from our, for example, our group from the general population of Russia or any other country. This census data, in theory, are available in every country, so you know gender, age distribution, geographical distribution, whatever, a lot of descriptive statistics against which you can compare your study groups. But there is nothing of the kind, say, on Facebook. And finally, there has been a lot of network research that involves small networks, like a school class or an even network online. We have no idea if regularities found there will scale to large networks. Maybe in large networks, all processes or features of human communication are different. Maybe not, but we don't know unless we check it. So I will give you four examples of the research addressing each of these questions. Three of them are from our own research, and one of them is from other research. It just happens so because we do a lot of research and conduct it here, and we use this data a lot. So the first research addresses, the first question about pro-social group, and it is pro-social groups, and this is devoted to observers for fair elections. This is the social movement that was born on the wave of protests against electoral fraud back in 2011-2012. It has been very active and very pressured by the government. And it has used Vkontakte before it moved to Facebook as a tool of communication. So our question was, it has divisions in every district of St. Petersburg. But some divisions are much more successful in terms of recruiting members than others. Why is that so? What helps and what hinders these processes? What helps these observers to be successful? So what data did we collect? We collected, first of all the data from Vkontakte groups. Everything that was there, including networks of friendship and including their text and likes and everything else. And then we got the data on how many observers actually showed up on polling stations on the electoral date of 2014 in the role of observers. And this was really very difficult data to collect because you had to be there in the headquarters of the observers and to monitor all the phone calls and all the incoming, outgoing communication to understand how many really came. And what do we get as the main result? Yes, there is a very large and visible correlation between group size, I mean online group size, its activity, its connectedness, and the size of the offline turnout on the polling stations. But the people who show up really in the offline setting are not necessarily those who were the most active
and the most connected and the most popular in the online groups. So what does it mean? That means for practically for social movement leaders that it does make a difference if you invest in online communication and promote your movement. But you should not expect that the members, those who would come, will be necessarily the same people that are active online. And you should not like think that you have failed with your online communication if people who have showed up offline are different. Because online communication does matter, but it works in a slightly different way that you might expect. And we could not have obtained these data, these conclusions, had we had no access to this online data. This research has raised a lot of ethical questions from both us as authors and from our reviewers, because did we ask informed consent from all 22,000 members of online communities? No, we didn't. We couldn't have. This is just unrealistic. Could we ask every person who came to an offline polling station for an informed consent? No, we couldn't. We did agree, of course, with the leadership of this movement. It was a very difficult task of trust collaboration. But we did, and they agreed. Does this endanger the movement participants? Well, first of all, we don't store this data in Russia. Once the personal data of those who came and those who were online were matched, this was done only one computer, it was never copied here, it was never transferred online, and it was just transferred to Italy physically with the researcher, Galina. She left for Italy and she took this data with her, and they now exist only there, not here. One of the things that ensured and guaranteed our goodwill for not abusing this data was your visit. How could you guarantee? How could you create an incentive of the researchers to not endanger the subjects of research? Well, in this case, it was personal involvement of one of the researchers into this movement. Galina Slivanova is a passionate observers movement member. She shares all the risks of those people. The circumstance that guarantees a cooler analysis of all this is that the other researcher is not involved and sees it from the outside. Okay. Next example. Now, what if you have an opposite case? You have an anti-social group, a group that is really dangerous. What do you do with it? Do you have a right to study them and how do you do it? So this was a very interesting research done mainly by our colleagues Yuri Rykov and Peter Melas. And Peter Melas is an e-health expert and researcher. Has anyone of you heard of AIDS denialists? So these are people who deny the existence of AIDS. And why is it important? Because it causes deaths, really, in the offline world. In South Africa, once they had a president for 5 years who was AIDS denialist, and his minister for health was AIDS denialist. And this, according to the analysis, this caused 300,000 of direct deaths in that country. So it's really very dangerous, a very dangerous ideology. They have their own pseudo-scientific scientific explanations to all this. And so when we came to collect data, oh, that's very dark. You can barely see anything. Okay. When we came there to collect the data, obviously we didn't ask for their informed consent. We were like just trying to understand why people come there, what do they do with newcomers to recruit them, what do they do to sort of debunk the counter arguments, to struggle with counter arguments, and how their communication is structured. So if you can see anything, here is the core. Red are those who write messages, yellow are those who leave likes, and blue are those who just group members, and here you have a huge periphery who are not connected with friendship ties. And if you look at the minority who is poor at the core, you can do it manually. After, once you have detected them among 15,000 people, you can look at them manually, you can see what they write. And from this qualitative reading, you can easily see that there is no way you can like influence these core people. But if you go and sample people from periphery, you can easily see that those are the ones on whom an intervention can be targeted. An intervention aimed at changing their behavior and their beliefs. So this also couldn't have been done without looking at this connected data, this connected network of friendships and of communication. This research actually received a lot of public attention and media coverage because it's so like, it's a hot topic for media. They like topics like this. And once it turned out that the new Ombudsman for Child's Rights was the member of this group. So we are having some problems here. The third example. This is not our research, and this is actually not a typical research project that you expect. This exists only in Russian, and this is called Web Census. If you could click this link and go online, this is a very interesting group of researchers. They have collected an enormous number of data from Kontakte to make different descriptive statistics and to make benchmarks of population, Kontakte population, against which any researcher could measure his or her group study. Like if you have AIDS denialists and you want to understand how different they are in terms of education, geographical distribution, or whatever, from general Kontakte population, you need to know the distributions in the Kontakte population. And this is what this research provides you. So here you have an enormous number of descriptive statistics, gender and age here, it's all in Russian, unfortunately. Names, that's not very interesting. Education, that's very, very informative. Migration, that's very, very important. Where, what are donor regions, what regions are recipients of migrants. Friendship. This is also very important because they also study some transborder friendship and they tell you how much this or that group is inclined to have friends outside this region or even outside this country. And they not only have CSV tables, but they also provide you with interactive maps. If it works fast. Okay, so you've got an interactive map. You can choose an age range, and you can see the distribution, the geographic distribution of users of this age and their share in the general population and also the gender distribution. And there are many, many more things you can find here. Can you imagine anything like this for Facebook? It would never really permit doing this. And this is for any sociological research to be representative and to be verifiable. Now I'm coming to the final example. About big networks. One of the reasons why we usually see research on friendship based on even networks only is precisely because Facebook asks for informed consent from, this is the terms that Facebook asks for, informed consent from each user to provide his or her data. And therefore, we cannot study anything larger than even networks. And moreover, we can't even study a small group, even if it's small group, like a school class. We can't study it without consent from all members, to say nothing of larger networks. So, but it is still possible in that. And so we decided to look what can we do about it. Our research was about social capital, so we were basically interested why some people have more friends, more connections, and are better embedded. You said it was 1 hour.
1 hour,
maybe still 5 minutes for questions. Yeah, but it's only 36 minutes past.
Okay.
Yeah, so I come for 10 minutes.
No, almost more than the break.
Okay, so we wanted to know why some people are much better embedded in online social networks than others. What is social capital? Social capital there are two main distinctions between bridging and bonding. Bonding capital and bonds. Close relations. These are your closest loved ones who will rescue you in a difficult situation. And bridges are people who connect you to other people you might need for like job, for finding a job or something. And these are different types of social capital, social connections. And the other distinction is local versus global capital. You can measure your capital within your eager network from among your friends only. But you can measure your position in an entire school class, entire organization, entire village or entire city to see where you are. And so we wanted to study all of them and to see what influences them. So we have the data, this slide only shows you that we have used both global and local measurements, and they include both region and foreign capital. If you want to have the links, the references, you can check the pictures. And so this data set is really big. These are really like almost 300,000 users there and lots of connections. So it's a huge network. And it covers a typical middle-sized Russian city of Vologda, whose picture you saw on the very first opening slide. It's a typical Russian city north to St. Petersburg and Moscow. We also did a gamified app, and we have the data, the self-reported data matched with the observational data, but we don't report. I don't report them now. They're still on the. So here, this is a difficult table to understand, but I want you to focus on only one thing here. Yes, we have found, what does it do here? We have found some predictors of all types of capitals. Those are the same predictors for all of them because different types of social capital have shown to be correlated. But one absolute thing that we find that bonding capital is negatively related to all these predictors, which means that, for example, the more likes you have, the lower is your bonding capital. What is that? That doesn't make sense at all. So why are other types of capital positively related to different types of predictors? But this one is negatively related. This information. Then we looked at the entire network and compared the role of the friendship and compared it to different types of random class. We found that in terms of clustering, like in terms of grouping, the presence of relatively isolated groups there, which is very close to small world network, which should be a collection of relatively isolated groups. But in terms of centralization, which is closer to scale-free graphs, which means that it is actually a hierarchical graph. What does this mean? That you have indeed there small clusters, but they are also quite well related to a number of city-level leaders. So we have two layers of connections. And of course, when suppose that your friendship network is growing, at first you only have your family and your closest friends, and then you acquire other connections in Vologda. This does not diminish your bonding capital. That only adds bridging ties on top of bonding ties. And then your personal networks becomes less connected, less closed, more dispersed, and the measure that measures bonding capital starts thinking that your bonding capital has fallen, which is absolutely false. And this makes us conclude that this measure of transitivity and local clustering coefficient that has been for decades used as a measure of bonding capital doesn't measure bonding capital. It may measure group closure, network closure, but not bonding capital. And this conclusion would not have been obtained without look at the big picture of the entire network. Okay, I think I have maybe 3 more minutes here before we have 15 minutes for questions. From here, much of which has been already said in the podium discussion, so I will not be going into details. There are 3 potential stakeholders for owning and controlling the data. Let's imagine what happens if any one of them controls the data fully. If those are users, then what do we have in this case? It would be very, very difficult to do any research. Like, look at the recent European General Data Protection Regulation. You can do nothing after that in terms of research. What will be the consequences? This would give the advantages to the competitors of legal and goodwill researchers outside the European Union. So more shady practices, more illegal data acquisition, and in fact, those who are outside Europe, maybe for example in China, will get a quicker progress in terms of internet research and its application. But what if business owns the data? Then nobody except the business will understand at all what happens to this data, neither users nor the society, whatever. It's pretty obvious. If the society opens the data, like if it's public property, so of course we can see the risks here. If it's a good society, because usually society means the government, actually, in fact. It is not supposed to be the same, but in fact it is. So if you have a good government aimed at good things, if you make public something that could have been monetized, it inevitably will undermine the business, the respective business, so that the businesses might have problems and go out of business at all. And I'm not like mentioning that. This is the final slide. So there are some provocative ideas on what you can do with this. The first thing is creating incentive.